Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases, especially written, for people learning English. On today's program, you will hear about the winners of the Nobel Prize in Chemistry. Three researchers were honored for their work on a substance that is necessary for life, protein. Then, Bryan Lynn explains changes to Meta's Instagram meant to protect children. After that, the lesson of the day. Read and hear all of our stories at learningenglish.voanews.com. But first, three scientists who developed methods to predict the structure of proteins and build new ones have won the Nobel Prize in Chemistry. The winners were American David Baker, a professor at the University of Washington, Briton Demis Hassabis, head of Google's DeepMind Research Laboratory in London, and American John Jumper, a top researcher at DeepMind. The lab centers on artificial intelligence, AI, methods. Protein is one of the most important substances to life on Earth. Baker succeeded in building new kinds of proteins. Hassabis and Jumper solved a problem that had existed for 50 years. They were finally able to use AI to predict the structure of proteins. The Nobel Committee for Chemistry said the discoveries hold enormous potential. For example, committee members said the ability to build new proteins could lead to the discovery of new drugs and vaccines. It could also help scientists develop extremely small materials called nanomaterials and small sensors. Heiner Link is chair of the Nobel Committee for Chemistry. He said the award honored research that made connections for the first time between amino acid sequences and protein structures. That was actually a grand challenge in chemistry, and in particular biochemistry, for many years, Link said. Baker first designed a new protein in 2003. Since then, his research group has produced many different proteins. It seems that you can almost construct any type of protein now with this technology, said Professor Johan Akvist of the Nobel Committee. The committee said Hassabis and Jumper created an AI model called AlphaFold 2. It has been able to predict the structure of nearly all 200 million proteins researchers have identified. Link said, "Proteins are the molecules that enable life. Proteins are building blocks that form bones, skin, hair, and tissue." He added, "To understand how life works, we first need to understand the shape of proteins." Link said that in 2020, Hassabis and Jumper were able to use AI methods to finally crack the code. That made it possible to predict the complex structure of any known protein in nature. There are many possible uses for the technology. Researchers should be able to use it to better understand how organisms develop resistance to antibiotics. They might also be able to create images of chemical substances called enzymes that can break down plastic. The committee said Baker had developed computational tools that enable scientists to design new proteins with new shapes and functions. Baker noted that Hassabis and Jumper's work in AI had greatly helped his team. The breakthroughs made by Demis and John on protein structure prediction really highlighted to us the power that AI could have, he said. And that led us to apply these AI methods to protein design, and that has greatly increased the power and accuracy. Baker was asked during a phone call with Nobel officials and reporters if he had a favorite protein. He said it would be difficult to choose, but he noted that one designed during the pandemic proved to be effective in protecting against the coronavirus. And I've been very excited about the idea of a nasal spray, of little designed proteins that would protect against all possible pandemic viruses, Baker said. Hassabis is a leader in Britain's technology industry. He received a knighthood earlier this year for his work in AI. He helped establish DeepMind in 2010. Google later bought the lab. DeepMind first gained wide attention by developing an AI system that was able to defeat the human world champion in the Chinese game of Go faster than expected. This year's Nobel Prize in Chemistry is worth about $1 million. Half of the prize will go to Baker. Hassabis and Jumper will share the other half. Award ceremonies for the 2024 Nobel Prize winners will be held on December 10th. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
Meta's Instagram service recently introduced some built-in tools designed to protect young users. The changes also give parents more control over their children's accounts to improve safety and limit the amount of time spent on the social networking app. Instagram says the new tools aim to reassure parents that teens are having safe experiences. The main change was the establishment of teen accounts, which Meta says was developed with parents and teens in mind. The Associated Press offers the following tips as a guide for parents to get the most out of the new tools. Instagram already restricts anyone under 13 from signing up for the service. Now, teen accounts will automatically be set to private. That means they will have to accept or reject requests from new followers. Other users will not be able to see a teen user's posts and videos or communicate with the account. Teens will also face messaging restrictions. They can only receive direct messages from people they are following or who follow them. But they can still send messages to other accounts. Teen accounts will also restrict certain kinds of material or content. This will include sensitive subjects such as videos of people fighting or content that pushes methods to improve appearance. In addition, Instagram's anti-bullying tools will be set to the highest level to prevent offensive words and phrases in comments and direct message requests. To restrict usage time, teens will get a message to stop using the app after it has been open for more than an hour. This message can be ignored, however. The new limits will be turned on automatically for all teens, but 16 and 17-year-olds will have the ability to turn them off. Children under 16 will need parental permission to do so. Teens might also seek to lie about their age to get around the restrictions, but Meta has made it more difficult for them to do so. Young users are required to confirm their ages by uploading an identification card or by sending a short video of themselves. Instagram says it will also begin testing artificial intelligence, AI software, early next year that will aim to prevent false birth dates from being accepted. If a parent does not think the limits for their child are strong enough, they can add more protective controls. For example, a parent has the ability to see who their teen has traded messages with within the past 7 days. The new tools also provide controls for parents to set daily limits for Instagram use. A parent can also block a teen from using Instagram during specific times of the day and follow subjects they are seeing. To set up additional controls, a parent first needs to set up family supervision on his or her account. On the mobile app, this can be done by going into settings and scrolling to find the family center to activate the tools. Next, the teen account will have to invite a parent. This will be done in the form of a link the teen can send by text message to the parent. After accepting the invite, the teen user has 48 hours to confirm the parent's response. The restrictive tools will be automatically activated for anyone under 18 who now signs up for Instagram in the US, Britain, Canada, and Australia. For existing accounts, the restrictions will be put in place by mid-November. The protections will be available for teens in the European Union's 27 countries beginning later this year. And the rest of the world will get teen accounts for Instagram in January. Meta says it will also bring the changes to other services like Facebook next year. I'm Bryan Lynn.
You are listening to the VOA Learning English podcast. Now, Bryan Lynn is here to talk more about his technology report. Thanks for joining me, Bryan.
Of course, Mario. Thank you for having me.
This week, your report dealt with changes made by Meta, that aim to better protect young users and give parents more control. How have critics of Meta reacted to the new tools?
I'd say that as a whole, most groups that have been critical of Meta in the past on this issue and have long called on the company to make changes recognized that these new changes are a step in the right direction. However, most have said they simply do not go far enough. One continuing criticism, for example, is that the recently announced tools did not specifically address wider issues related to how just being on a social media service like Instagram can harm a child's self-image and lead to depression or more serious outcomes.
And in what ways have the critics said the changes that are taking effect do not go far enough?
So one issue I've heard brought up is that with some of these tools, young users will still be able to easily find ways to avoid the restrictions. One example mentioned in the report is that although Instagram messages will be restricted coming into the account, young users will still be able to message strangers. Also, the warnings that aim to restrict the amount of time they spend on the service can be ignored. But clearly, it is going to take a lot for some critics to be satisfied with whatever changes are made, and they are actually still pushing to get legislation passed to force even deeper protections.
Okay, that's all the time we have today. Thanks for being here, Bryan.
Sure, Mario, thank you.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Next, Jill Robbins and Andrew Smith bring you The Lesson of the Day, a program that expands on the VOA Learning English video series, Let's Learn English. Today, explore interjections, and then learn about some surprising direct and indirect objects. And be sure to listen tomorrow for Everyday Grammar. On that program, hear about phrasal verbs. English learners face the difficulty of learning a lot of phrasal verbs. We explain their history and give some helpful advice on how to spot and use these verbs.
Is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
On the lesson of the day, we like to help you learn from even small amounts of the language you hear in the Let's Learn English series.
Sometimes you can learn a lot from just a little.
Listen now to the beginning of lesson 32 of the series. See if you can notice little expressions Anna uses. First, to show excitement, and then to show that she is worried.
Hello! Today is a big day. My first children's show is on television. Woohoo! I'm excited and nervous.
Hello, Anna.
Hello, Ms. Weaver.
Some people, are going to watch your children's show. After they watch it, they'll tell me what they liked and what they didn't like.
Oh, dear.
Oh, dear. Is what we call an interjection. Those are words, sounds, or phrases we use to quickly show feelings. Oh, dear, shows that Anna is worried about whether people will like her new children's show.
Ms. Weaver also looks very serious in the video, so I think Anna is worried about that, too. But what interjection did Anna use to show her excitement?
Hello! Today is a big day. My first children's show is on television. Woohoo! I'm excited.
Woohoo is right. When we get good news or are excited about something, we sometimes use this interjection. It's not really a word. It's more just like a sound.
It's an interjection.
Interjection, 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 interjection.
And what other interjection does Anna often say to show she is excited? Here's a hint. It begins with the ah sound. And it is also a real word in English.
And the interjection is?
Awesome!
Awesome!
Americans say this expression a lot, but our listeners might be curious to know what other meaning the word has.
Awesome is an adjective, and the noun form of the word is awe, spelled A-W-E. To feel awe is to feel very amazed, or even frightened, or fearful when you see or experience something big or special.
For example, if you are looking at a huge mountain, or the world's tallest building, or a natural wonder such as the Grand Canyon in the United States, you might have the feeling of awe.
And so, you would say that the mountain or building is an awesome sight, or an awesome thing to behold.
Behold is sort of a fancy word that just means to see or look at.
Jill, Anna said, oh dear, because she suddenly felt worried. What are some other polite interjections we use when we are disappointed, upset, or worried?
We say, uh-oh, if we think something is wrong. Like if we've made a mistake or a machine is broken. And if we get bad news or a bad result, we can say polite interjections like, darn, rats, shucks, or shoot.
That's right. Believe it or not, we sometimes make mistakes when we're doing this podcast, and we might say something like that. For another example, if you are playing a sport and you make a bad mistake, you might say, rats.
Of course, native speakers also say curse words, or words that are not polite, as interjections to express negative feelings, such as frustration, anger, or disappointment. But we'll let our listeners find those on their own.
You're darn right we will.
I'm Jill Robbins, and you're listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Now, let's go back to the beginning of Lesson 32. Listen to Ms. Weaver again.
Some people are going to watch your children's show. After they watch it, they'll tell me what they liked and what they didn't like.
Here's a bit of grammar for our listeners. In her second sentence, Miss Weaver uses what we call a noun clause as the direct object of the verb tell.
After they watch it, they'll tell me what they liked and what they didn't like.
The noun clause is the words what they liked. a clause has a subject and a verb. The subject is the pronoun they, and the verb is liked. Together, the words what they liked act just like a noun because they are the object of the verb tell.
They'll tell me what they like.
One mistake people learning English make is they will say, what did they like in this situation? Because the word what makes it seem like a question. But it's not a question. It's just a noun, object of the verb.
That's right. Like if I say, tell me the answer, the word answer is the object. So the noun clause works the same way. I can say, tell me what you think. What you think is the object.
But what about the pronoun me in the sentence, tell me what you think?
That is called the indirect object. It's like saying, tell what you think to me. But in English, we usually put the pronoun before the direct object.
We can hear more examples of the indirect object in Lesson 32. Listen as Anna explains the special machine she will use in her children's show.
Hello, I'm Anna. Welcome to the time-traveling treehouse. This is not a usual treehouse. It can time travel! That's why it's called the time-traveling treehouse.
Anna, do not forget me.
Of course not. This is my partner, Mindy.
My name means massive information navigation device for you.
That means we can travel to many places and learn many things. Kids from all over the world ask us questions. We find them answers.
Woohoo! That is right, Anna.
Mindy, what is our first question?
Layla asks us this question.
We hope you heard the interjection that the machine named Mindy used. And the examples with pronouns as indirect objects, placed before the direct object, were these.
Kids from all over the world ask us questions. We find them answers.
And
Layla asks us this question.
On our website at learningenglish@voanews.com, you can download for free the lesson plan that goes with Lesson 32 of Let's Learn English. It explains direct and indirect objects and many other things about Lesson 32.
And now, here's a little poem that uses many indirect objects. You gave me your hand and opened your heart. You gave us a chance to make a new start. I'll tell you my hopes. I'll tell you my dreams. I'll give you my love and all that it means. Like rivers that run from hills to the sea, we'll flow day by day, together and free. I offer my words. I open my door. The day you walk in, I need nothing more.
Well, that's really sweet, Andrew. I hope your girlfriend likes it when you find her.
I hope she does too.
And remember that you can ask us questions by writing us at learningenglish@voanews.com. You could also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Thanks for listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.